warm welcome to all of you in the lecture series of basic electronics on BISEC. Myself, Professor Milind Shah from VGC Chandkhera, Ahmedabad. As we are learning the second chapter of this subject, circuit techniques, circuit analysis techniques, and today we will discuss the second topic, mesh current analysis. All the material taken in this presentation is from the textbook Introduction to Electrical Engineering from M.S. Sharma from Oxford Press. Before we start today's topic, we take a brief revision of the last lecture content that we have discussed. In the last lecture, we have discussed the one method of the circuit analysis, and which is a node voltage analysis. This method is based on the KCL, and this is a very well-ordered systematic method of analysis for solving complicated network problems. As we have learned in the last lecture, that there is a step-by-step, that this is a step-by-step procedure to solve any problems. Node voltage is based on the KCL. This method is applicable to all type of the network topology, either planar or non-planar. And now we start with the today's topic is a mesh current method. This is a second category of the analysis techniques which is utilized for the circuit analysis. This method is based on the KVL, Kirchhoff voltage law. Mesh current method is applicable to only planar network. The planar network are the network which can be laid out to contain only meshes. So the network which can be designed in the form of only loops, meshes mean the loops, then this mesh current method can be applied. While the node voltage analysis can be applied to the non-planar network also. So this is a limitation to the mesh current method. But in some categories, some network, compared to node voltage, mesh current will be useful. So today we will learn this method and we will find out that what type of network are suitable for the mesh current analysis. So first of all, we learn the basic terminology of the mesh current. That a mesh current is a fictitious current which is defined as the one circulating around a mesh of the circuit in a certain direction. A clockwise direction is traditionally chosen. So usually in this method, we assume that there is one current is flowing through the mesh in circular fashion and its movement is in the clockwise. Branch currents can be found in terms of mesh currents whose solution is obtained from the independent simultaneous equations. The number of necessary equations in the mesh analysis method is equal to the number of independent loops or meshes. So this is same case for the node voltage analysis in which the number of equations are equal to the number of unknown node voltages. So same case is here. The number of equations are equal to the number of loop current in the circuits. So we learn this with a simple example. Assume that the circuit is consist of two voltage source and a current source with three resistors R1, R2 and R3. So first of all, we will transform this into the equivalent circuit which contain only voltage source. As we have learned in the node voltage analysis, that in node voltage we are transferring all voltage sources into equivalent current sources, while in mesh current we will try to replace all the independent current source in parallel with the resistor, here I3 and R3, into its equivalent voltage source in series with the resistors by using the source transformation method. So you can look at here, V3 is equal to I3 into R3. Now we write the mesh current equation using KVL. So if you look at here, first we have transformed the current source into voltage source. After that, we need to identify the loops. So if you look at here, this V1, R1, R2 and V2 will form one loop or one mesh. Second is V2, R2, R3 and V3 will form the second mesh. So after finding out the number of meshes, we need to assign the current circulating through the mesh. And the number or the name of the current will be the number of mesh. So this is the first loop, so we use the I1. This is second loop, so we use the I2. After designating the current circulating through the loop, we apply the KVL on each loop. So if we apply the KVL on this first loop, loop A, B, D and A, we can find this equation. So this is I1 R1 plus, if you look at for the R2, from R2 two current are passing. One is I1, which is a downside. Second is I2, which is a upside. So both are opposite of each other. So we put here I1 minus I2. We take I1 as positive because we are moving in the direction of the I1. So we take I1 minus I2 into R2 equal to the voltage source present in the loop. Now if you look at here, if we move in the direction of I1, when we move through V1, the voltage is increasing. We are moving from negative V1 to positive terminal of V1. So our voltage is increased. So we take V1 as a positive. If you look at for V2, when we move in the direction of I1 from V2, we are moving from positive terminal of V2 to negative terminal of V2. It means the voltage is decreasing. So we take here minus V2. Similarly, we write the equation for the second loop. Loop is B, C, D and B. So as we move in the direction of the I2, we have I2, R3, then from R2, again two current, I1 downside, I2 upside. We are moving in the direction of I2, so we take I2 as positive. So we write I2 minus I1 into R2 equal to, if you look at here, when we pass through V2, voltage is increasing, so we take positive V2. When we pass through V3, voltage is decreasing, so we take minus V3. So in this way, by applying KVL, we find the two equations for two loops. So these are the equations we have derived by applying KVL, and now we restructure them. So we get the R1 plus R2 into I1. This R1 plus this R2 will be multiplied with I1. So we get R1 plus R2 into I1 minus I2 R2 equal to V1 minus V2. Similarly for this equation, R3 plus R2 will be added. So we have R2 plus R3 into I2. And here we have a minus I1 R2. So minus R2 I1 plus R2 plus R3 I2 equal to V2 minus V3. So from this loop, from this two loop, we have derived two equations. And now we generalize the rule to write this equation directly from the loop. Same as in case of the node voltage. In node voltage analysis, we have drafted the rules to write the node equations directly from the susceptance attached with the node as well as between the nodes and the current sources. So similarly, in the mesh current method, we can form the rules. So if you look at here, this equation is a three term. On left side, there are two terms. And on right side we have one term. The first term is related with the loop current. Second term is related with the component of the loop, which is also a part of any another adjoining loop. And the third term is concerned with the voltage source present in the loop. So we find out the first rule to write this term. In the first loop equation, means for loop 1 or for the current I1 with mesh current I1, the coefficient of I1 is the sum of the resistance in that mesh. So whenever we write the first term, means the term for the mesh current, its coefficients are the addition of all the resistance present in the mesh. Now we draft the rule for the second term. The coefficients of I2 means the current which is flowing in the adjoining mesh. This is our main mesh, loop 1. We are writing equation for loop 1. And with loop 1, loop 2 is also attached through R2. So in this case, the coefficients of I2 is depending or is including the value of R2. The coefficients of I2 is in the negative sum of the resistances common to both meshes. So the I2 will be negative and its coefficient value will be the value of the resistors which are common between both meshes. So the R2 is a common resistor between loop 1 and loop 2, and so we put here minus R2 I2. Now for the right side term, the right hand side of the equation, this V1 minus V2, is the algebraic sum of the source voltage rises taken in the direction of I1. So when we move in the direction of the I1, if the voltage source, for a voltage source, if voltage is increasing, means from minus to plus is increasing. So if it is increasing, then we should take that voltage as a positive. And if voltage is decreasing, means plus to minus, the voltage is decreasing, then in that case, the voltage must be negative. So if you look at here, for V1, as we move in the direction of the I1, minus to plus, so V1 is increasing, so we take plus V1. For V2, we are moving from plus to minus, so voltage is decreasing, so we take minus V2. Similarly, the same three rule can be applied on this loop 2. Okay. So first, we are writing the equation for the I1. I1 is not the main current of loop 2. It is a current of adjoining loop. So the I1 has the minus coefficient, so we put here minus. The value of coefficients is equal to the resistance common between both loops. So R2 is a common. So we put here minus R2 as a coefficients of I1. Then plus. Now we add all the resistance present in mesh 2. So in mesh 2, we have a two resistance, R2 and R3. So we add both the resistance R2 plus R3. And this will form the coefficient for the I2. Now on the right hand side, as we move in the direction of the I2, if you look at here, for V3, the voltage is decreasing because we are moving from plus to minus. So we treat this V3 as a minus. So we write here minus V3. And as we move through V2, we are passing from minus to plus. So we take V2 as a positive. So we write here V2 as a plus, V3 as a minus. So in this way, we can form the mesh equations. And once we form this, we can solve these simultaneous equations. We get the values for I1 and I2. So now we take one example to learn this method. So we have taken the same circuitry that we have also analyzed in the node voltage analysis. Now we require to find out the current in the 10 volt source, means the current delivered by the 10 volt source, and we also find out the voltage across 10 ohm resistor. But this time we want to use mesh current method to analyze. If you look at here, we have a 2 voltage source and both are having the series resistance. Now step 1. Replace all current sources with shunt resistances by their corresponding Thevenin equivalents consisting of voltage sources with series resistance. This statement is an inverse of the statement used in the node voltage analysis. In node voltage, we are transferring voltage source to current source, while in mesh current, we are transferring current source to voltage source. The second statement is also a reverse of the node voltage method. For mesh current, conductances included in the circuit are replaced by their equivalent resistance. So we represent all the resistance in terms of ohm in mesh current. While in node voltage, we require to represent all the resistance present in the circuit by its equivalent conductance or susceptance. So now if you look at this circuitry, there is no current source present, so there is no need to transform to apply the source transformation on this circuit. Now we go for step 2. Step 2 is the identify elementary loops and choose a mesh current variable for each elementary loop. So in here we should find out the loops, one loop, then the second loop, then the third loop. We should designate the current to each loop, I1, I2 and I3. And as per the conventional we have accepted, always we show or represent this current flowing in the clock direction. So you can see here that I1 is also in clockwise, I2 is in clockwise, I3 is in the clockwise. Now we go for the step 3. Step 3 is to apply the KVL on the circuitry and find out the mesh equations. So we have 3 loops. We apply the KVL for each 3 loops and we form the equations. We use the previous 3 rules that we have designated or we have framed to write mesh equations directly from the given mesh. So we have a 3 mesh, one for I1, one for I2 and one for I3. These are the 3 equations. Now we understand each one. So if we take the I1, so first term, the term which is following the coefficients of I1 must be positive. So we have a plus sign here. And this coefficient is an addition of all the resistance present in the loop. So if you look at in the first loop, there are 3 resistance present, 5 ohm, 8 ohm and 20 ohm. So we add all these 3 resistance, 5 plus 8 plus 20 into I1. After that, we write the term for I2 and I3. But both this current have the negative coefficient, so we use negative sign for each one. The coefficients of I2 will form the component which is common between I1 and I2, means first loop and second loop. So this 20 ohm resistor is common between the first loop and second loop. So this 20 will form the coefficients of the I2 in the loop equation. So we have a minus 20 I2. Similarly, for this third loop I3, the component which is common between third loop and the first loop is a 8 ohm resistance. So this 8 will form the coefficients for I3. So we have a minus 8 I3. Now inside this loop, so now we write the right side term. In this loop, we have only one source, and as we move in the direction of I1, voltages increase from minus to plus. So we take the 10 as a plus here. Similarly, we write the equation for the second loop. So the coefficients of I1 is negative and its value is equal to the common resistance between loop 1 and 2. So between loop 1 and 2, the common value is 20. So we use minus 20 as a coefficients of I1. For I2, we add all the resistance present in the loop. So for I2, the resistance present in the loop are 20 ohm, 10 ohm, and 25 ohm. So we add these three, 20 plus 10 plus 25, which are equal to this into I2. For I3, again, we have a minus sign. And the coefficient is a common component between second loop and third loop. So between I2 and I3, so it is a 10 ohm. So the 10 will form the coefficients of the I3. So we have a minus 10 I3 equal to. If you look at here this loop, there is no voltage source inside this loop. So the right hand side will be zero. Okay. Now we write the equation for the third loop, I3. So the coefficients of I1 and I2 are negative and these are the common component. So between I1 and I3, common term is 8. So we have minus 8 I1. Between the I2 and I3, the common term is 10. So we have minus 10 I2. For I3, three resistors are in loop. 4, 10 and 8. So their addition will form the coefficients of I3. So 4 plus 10 plus 8 equal is into I3 equal to. Now we write the right hand side term. So in the third loop we have only one voltage source which is of 20 volt. Now as we move in the direction of the clockwise, the voltage is increasing from minus to plus. And so 20 will be positive. So in this way we can directly write down the mesh equation for all the three loops. So now we have simplified all the three equations. So we got these three equations for the three unknown I1, I2 and I3. Now step 4 is the same as of the node voltage analysis. Simultaneously solve the independent equations for the unknown mesh currents by either Gauss elimination method or Cramer's rule. And in this case the solution that we get is I1 is equal to 1.132 ampere, I2 is equal to 0.711 ampere and I3 is equal to 1.645 ampere. So in this way we can find out the unknown mesh current which are circulating inside the all three loops. Now step 5 is to find out the unknown quantity demanded in the problem. So there are two quantity demanded. One is the current delivered by the 10 volt source, this current which is passing through 5 ohm resistor, and second is the voltage across the 10 ohm. Now we have a three current I1, I2 and I3 we have found out using mesh current method. So if you look at the first loop, the I1 is the current which is passing through 5 ohm resistor. So it means that the 10 volt source is delivering I1 current to this circuitry. And so the current in the 10 volt source or current delivered by the 10 volt source is equal to I1. And as per the solutions we have got, I1 is equal to 1.132 ampere. Next is the 10 ohm resistor. And we need to find out the voltage drop across this 10 ohm resistor. So the voltage drop can be found out by using Ohm's law. It is IR. Now the R is 10. Current passing through these resistors are two. One is in this way, one is in the opposite way. So by the conventional method, we take the I2 as a main current. So I2 is plus and minus I3. So we write here I2 minus I3, which is equal to minus 9.34 volt. So this is the voltage drop present across the 10 ohm resistor. So in this way, by using also the mesh current method, we can easily find out the desired unknown quantity in the circuitry. Now we take one more example to strengthen our fundamentals in the mesh current method. So in this circuitry, we have a one current source, we have one voltage source, and we need to find out the current delivered by the 10 volt source and the voltage across the 3 ohm resistor. This example will teach us the concept of super mesh. So as we have learned the super node concept in the node voltage analysis, here we learn the super mesh concept. If you recall, the super node concept will be applied whenever we have a voltage source without the series resistance. Similarly, the super mesh concept will be applicable whenever we have a current source without the parallel, direct parallel resistance. So if you look at here, this 5 ohm 5 ampere current source, there is no direct parallel resistor connected across it. So we cannot easily transform this current source into voltage source. So let's see how to apply the mesh current method in this example. So step one is to convert all current source to voltage source. As there is no resistor in direct parallel with 5 ampere current source, this cannot be converted to equivalent voltage source. As per the source transformation method, if you want to convert any current source into voltage source, we need the parallel resistance. Now in this circuitry, it is absent, so we cannot transfer this thing. So now we go for the step 2. In step 2, we will identify the elementary loops and choose the mesh current variable for each elementary loop. So we can form like this I1, I2 and I3 from the preliminary overview of the circuit. But the problem here is that we cannot express the voltage across the current source, this 5 ampere current source, in terms of the mesh currents I1 and I2, as there is no any direct parallel resistor, we cannot find out the voltage drop across 5 ampere. And in that case, we cannot write KVL. So how to solve this problem? So we form a super mesh which includes mesh 1 and mesh 2. So we form a super mesh. So we combine both the mesh which are having a common current source which cannot be transformed. Now we form the loop equation. So if we recall that in the node voltage analysis, the super node we form, and the property of the super node is that it also fulfill KCL. It means incoming current and outgoing current are equal. Same thing, same concept can also be applied to the super mesh. So for the super mesh, if we can apply the KVL, it must be fulfilled. So if we apply the KVL on the super mesh, then we have a 1 into I1, so 1 I1 plus 2 I1 minus I3 plus 4 I2 minus I3 plus 10. So actually, if we recall the equations that we have formed in the node voltage or the mesh current, that as we move in the direction of the current and if the voltage is decreasing, then we put the minus sign. But this is applicable for the right side term. So this 10 volt must be here and it will be minus 10. But if we transfer or if we shift this voltage source on the left side, then it will become plus 10. And so in this equation, we have written plus 10. Now we apply the, now we find out the super mesh constrained equation. So if you look at here, from this branch, two current are passing. One is the I1, which is downside, and one is I2, which is upside. Now, if you look at here, this branch has one current source, which is an independent source, 5 ampere. So this current source will maintain the current of this branch is 5 ampere. It means that I2 minus I1 must be 5 ampere. So this is the constraint equation that I2 minus I1 is equal to 5. Now we apply the KVL on mesh 3 in the direction of the I3. So we get that 3I3 plus 4I3 minus I2 plus 2I3 minus I1. And if you look at this, there is no voltage source in this loop. So I put here 0 on the right hand side. So now from this analysis, we have derived these sets of equations. The first one is the minus I1 plus I2 is equal to 5. This equation we have derived using the super mesh constraint. The way we have formed the super mesh, it is a constraint that the difference between I1 and I2 must be 5 ampere. This is the equation that we have derived using the super mesh. And this is the equation we have derived for the mesh 3. Super mesh is, if I recall you, is a combination of the loop 1 and 2. We have merged loop 1 and 2 and form a bigger mesh. So now we have a 3 equation and there are 3 unknowns, I1, I2 and I3. We can apply either Gauss elimination method or the Cramer's rule to solve this loop equation. So now step 4 is to solve these equations. And the solutions is I1 is equal to minus 50 by 9, I2 is minus 5 by 9, I3 is equal to minus 40 by 27. So in this way, we can solve the mesh loop equations. So here we have learned that how to apply the super mesh concept whenever we cannot transform the current source into equivalent voltage source. Now step 5, by using these values, we should find out these two. Find the current delivered by the 10 volt source and the voltage across the 3 ohm resistors. So if you look at here, the current delivered by the 10 volt source is naturally I2. And the voltage across the 3 ohm resistor is 3I3, so we can find out this is very easily by this one, by simply multiplying 3I3, and we can solve it. Now we take one example on the dependent sources. So the problem is that find the current in the 5 volt source and the voltage across the 5 ohm resistor. So here, if you look at this circuit, this is the same circuit that we have used in the node voltage analysis. It has one independent voltage source and one dependent current source. But the dependent current source is having a parallel direct resistance. We need to find out the current delivered by the 5 volt source and the voltage across the 5 ohm resistor. So step one is to convert all current sources to voltage source. So if you look at here, here we have only one current source, which is a dependent source, and it has a parallel resistance of 10 ohm. The voltage controlled current source and its parallel resistance are converted into a voltage controlled voltage source and series resistance. So if you look at here, this is a dependent current source and its value is depending on a voltage V1. So it is called voltage controlled current source. Some external voltage is controlling its value, its current value. And so it is called voltage controlled current source. And it has a parallel resistance of 10 ohm. And these two can be converted into again a dependent source. But this time, this is a voltage controlled voltage source. And it has a series resistance. So now we do this transformation. So we take only these two component. We apply the Ohm's law. So the voltage is V is equal to I into R. Okay. So we get this one. This is a dependent voltage source. Its value is 0.5 V1 into 10 is equal to 5 V1. And we put this 10 ohm resistor in series with this dependent voltage source. So in this way, we can transform the voltage controlled current source into the voltage controlled voltage source. But the condition is that the current source must have the direct parallel resistance to transform. We use the Ohm's law or source transformation method to transform this from current to voltage source. So now our equivalent circuit contains only voltage source. It has 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 resistors and one independent voltage source. If you look at here, we have two loops. One loop consists of 5 volt source plus 10 ohm, then 4 ohm and this 2 ohm. Second loop is consist of 2 ohm, then controlled voltage source, then 10 ohm and 5 ohm. So now as we have identified the loops, now we assign the current circulating through the loops. So we have a I1 and I2 flowing through this. If you look at here, the current I1 is passing through the 5 volt, 10 ohm, 4 ohm and 2 ohm, while the I2 is passing from 2 ohm, the dependent source, 10 ohm and 5 ohm. Now we go for the step 3. So step 3 is the form equation for each mesh. So now as we have two mesh, we write the two equation for the each one. So for loop I1, this loop, for the first loop, we can write the equation. So as per the rule we have drafted, the coefficients of I1 are the addition of all the resistance present in the loop. So for the I1, we have a 10 plus 4 plus 2. So it is a 10 plus 4 plus 2. And for the I2, the coefficient sign is minus. And its value is a value equal to the common component. So it is a 2. So we put here minus 2I2 equal to the voltage source present in this loop is a 5 volt, and as we move in the direction of the I1, this voltage is increasing, means we are moving from minus terminal to plus terminal. So we put here plus 5. Now we apply this mesh current equations formation to the second mesh. So for the second mesh, the mesh current is I2. So for the I1 term, the sign is negative. Its coefficient must be equal to the value of the component which is common between loop 1 and loop 2. So we put here minus 2I1. Plus for I2, the coefficients are positive and it is equal to the addition of all the resistance present. So we have 2 plus 10 plus 5. So 2 plus 10 plus 5 I2 equal to. The voltage source present in this loop. If you look at here, in this loop only one dependent voltage source present and its value is 5V1. As we move in the direction of the I2, the voltage across this source is decreasing. We are moving from plus to minus. And so we write here minus 5V1 because the voltage is decreasing. So we write here minus 5V1. Now we rearrange these two equations and we get 16I1 minus 2I2 equal to 5 and minus 2I1 plus 17I2 equal to minus 5V1. Now if you look at here, in these equations we have a three unknown, I1, I2 and V1, because V1 is controlling this dependent voltage source. Now we want to establish the relation between I1, I2 and V1, because we have a three unknown, but we have till this point find out only two equations, one for the loop I1 and one for loop I2. As we have a three unknown, I1, V1 and I2, we need to form three equations so that we can simultaneously solve these three equations to find value of three unknown. Now if you look at the component 2 ohm resistor, it is carrying two current. I1 is a downside and I2 is the upside. So if we apply the Ohm's law on this resistor 2 ohm, then the voltage drop across the 2 ohm, V or V1 in this case, 2, the resistor value of the 2 into current passing through this. Now if we take this is plus and this is minus, then the I1 will be the positive current and I2 will be the negative current. So we can write that V1 is equal to 2I1 minus I2. So 2 is the resistance and this is the current, effective current passing through the 2 ohm resistor. So now we have three equations. So we have derived the relation between V1, I1 and I2 is V1 is equal to 2I1 minus I2. Now we combine this equation with the loop equation. So we have two loop equations which also are I1, I2 and V1. So now we take these equations, we replace the V1 by the 2I1 minus I2. So we have put it here, minus 2I1 plus 17I2 is equal to minus 5 into 2I1 minus I2. If we expand this, then it is equal to minus 10I1 plus 10I2. And if we simplify this equation, we get 8I1 plus 7I2 equal to 0. So thus, we have transferred three unknown system to two unknown. We have two equations and both are having a two unknown. So we solve this. So final set of equations are 16I1 minus 2I2 equal to 0 and 8I1 plus 7I2 equal to 0. So we have these two equations. We have two unknown. So we can simultaneously solve this equation to get the solution. The solution is equal to I1 is equal to 35 by 128 ampere and I2 is equal to minus 5 by 16 ampere. So in this way we can find out the I1 and I2, and this way we can apply the mesh current method also to the dependent sources. Now step 5. Now we need to find out the current in the 5 volt source, this source, and the voltage across the 5 ohm resistor. So if you look at here, for the 5 volt in this loop, current I1 is rotating. So the 5 volt is delivering the I1, or the I1 current is passing through the 5 volt. And so the current in the 5 volt source is equal to I1, and that we have already derived, it is 0.273 ampere. For voltage across the 5 ohm, we use the Ohm's law. So it is a V is equal to I into R, I is I2 and R is 5 ohm. So we have derived 5 I2 equal to 5 minus 5 by 16. So its value is minus 1.563 volt. So in this way, we can find out the all the required unknown quantity in this circuitry. Now we take one more examples of the dependent sources, and we learn that how to apply the mesh current method for the different situations. Okay, so in this example we have a dependent current source, and now we move to the example which has the dependent voltage source in the circuitry. So let that we want to apply the mesh current analysis to this circuitry. This circuit is contained . So if you look at here, we have one dependent voltage source of value 8 Ix, and the Ix is the current flowing through the 4 ohm, and our aim is to find Ix. So now as all the sources in this circuit are of voltage source, there is no need to apply the source transformation. We can directly apply the step 2 to find out our loop. So we have two loops. This one loop is a I1 and second loop has a I2, and now we write the equation for the each loop. So if we write the equation for the loop I1, if you look at here, that the first term is the I1. So the coefficients of I1 will be the resistance present in this loop. So these are 10 and 2. So we write the term 10 plus 2 into I1. Second current is the I2, and the common component is a 2 ohm. So we write here minus 2 I2. So as we have a two current, so we have a two term I1 and I2, Now we write the right hand side of this equation. So if you look at here, in this first loop we have only two source, 6 volt and 8. When we go in the direction of the I1, 6 is increasing and 8 is decreasing. So we write here 6 minus 8 ix. Similarly, we can apply the we can form the equation for the loop 2. So for loop 2, I1 is the adjoining current, common component is 2 ohm, so we have a minus 2 I1, and for I2 only 2 resistor 4 and 2, so we have a plus 4 plus 2 I2 equal to, if you look at here, we have a 2 sources, 8 ix, 4 volt. As we move in the direction of I2, this is increasing, this is decreasing, so we have a 8 ix minus 4 volt. Now if we look at this I2, we can show that the ix must be equal to I2. So the third equation we have derived is the I2 is equal to ix. So if we simplify this, all these equations, okay, if we simplify this equation, we get 12 I1 minus 2 I2 equal to 6 minus 8 I2. Second is minus 2 I1 plus 6 I2 equal to 8 I2 minus 4. So if we simplify these two equations, we get again more simplified equation as 2 I2 2 I1 plus I2 equal to 1 and I1 plus I2 equal to 2. And if we solve these two equations, we get that I1, so by simplifying these two equations, we get this 2 I1 plus I2 equal to 1 and I1 plus I2 equal to 2. If we solve these two equations, these are easy. I1 is equal to minus 1 ampere and I2 is equal to 3 ampere. As Ix is equal to I2 is equal to 3 ampere. So in this way, we can apply the mesh current analysis to the dependent sources as well as to any complex circuitry. In this lecture, we have learned that the step-by-step procedure for application of the mesh current. We have learned the concept of super mesh, that where to apply the super mesh. We have learned that how to apply the mesh current analysis to the dependent sources as well as the complex network. The procedure, if you look at the procedure for the mesh current and node voltage, are same. Step 1, transform the voltage or current source into vice versa. Step 2, from the node or from the loops, define the loop current. Step 3 is the form the loop equation. Step 4, solve the equations. Step 5, find out the unknown desired quantity in the problems. So in this way, we have completed two important methods, node voltage and mesh current analysis today. With this, we will end this lecture. Thank you. Thank you very much.